This program is rated universal. Good for general watching.
Game On is brought to you by...
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.
Game On. It's Game On. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
It's about less than 48 hours before we sign out 2019 and sign in on 2020. It's been a very glorious, handsome, miraculous 2018, not just for sports, but also for our daily lives as we celebrate the forthcoming New Year's. That is tomorrow, back one. Game On it is. Of course, so much happened just over the weekend, Boxing Day, Christmas holidays. And for Arsenal, I tell you what, it gets more worse and more miserable for them in regards to results from yesterday against Chelsea Football Club. So, Nicholas, no but the Ruby it is, and proudly brought to you by 1xBet. I'm joined by a brother and a friend in Brian Asimwe to do the conversation up until 3:30 p.m. Brian, good afternoon. Christmas is done. Boxing Day is done. You of all people should be telling us how you spent your holidays, because as far as we're concerned, everyone had like a similar routine. The guy behind the cameras went to Ibanda and then sarcastically mentioned how he came back without a scratch, but knocked on, how do you call those things in English? Butterflies, yes. But that being said, the dude said, I'm not really grateful for, you know, being, having come and gone back, rather having gone and come back safe and sound. But for you, just family, friends, church, and anything else in particular?
Lately, I spent a lot of time with family. I went to church first of all quite early in the morning. After that, moved back home. Obviously, everyone came together, shared so many memories, had a lot of fun, had a lot of good times. We reminisced on the other that has been 2019. Mm-hmm. I think it's come with lots of blessings, it's come with a lot of opportunities as well. And we decided that, you know what, let's do this again on 31st, mm-hmm. which is tomorrow. So I always treasure the quality time that I get mm-hmm. to spend with the family. But in between as well, Boxing Day, I go to watch a bit of football here and there. So it's been quite the eventful last couple of days.
People, human beings don't understand the value of life. And up until it's taken away from you, that's when you, you know, will understand the definition mm-hmm. of having life. Because we have millions who have been, of course, laid to rest this very year and the previous years. We've had people, as we speak, in intensive care, maybe going through surgery or something like that. But everyone, they stand before you, you know, no illness, they are not in debt, they are literally healthy, and they're still ungrateful. And you start to think, where is that taking them? But anyway, that being said, sporting-wise, quite an interesting Boxing Day for the Arsenal. And that being said, there's a talk as of now that Unai Emery, having been, you know, knocked out or massacred, Mikel Arteta after two games in charge, we are already starting to, they are already starting to judge him in such a way, because then from what we saw against Bournemouth and yesterday against Chelsea, yeah, was pretty much a reminder of what Arsenal's been in the last 10 years or so.
I think for me, you really struggle to make words of what seems to be becoming of Arsenal, because even when you felt like for the better part of that game against Chelsea, they really deserve to take all the 3 points. Somehow it was never going to be. And again, it raises a lot of question marks about the mentality of the team, mm-hmm. about the ideology of the players, about where the team seems to be at this point in time. Because for me, I'm one of those people that does not think that the league probably is that competitive to a point where teams like Arsenal cannot pick up 3 points against Bournemouth. Mm-hmm. They can lead for 80 minutes of the game against Chelsea and they can't put the result away. So it looks like there's something happening. And it's not just about the quality of the players, because some of these players are quite, the talented lads. Mm-hmm. But I think for me, it comes back to the mentality, it comes back to the mindset. They don't seem to have it in themselves that you can collect 3 points, you can beat up on a team like Chelsea. Mm-hmm. And again, it comes back to the fact that most of these guys have become quite soft over the years. There is lack of that hunger, that desire to win, that aggression for the players. And I think for me, Mikel Arteta quite well knows that it's going to be the challenge for him. How does he get the best out of the squad? How does he get all these players firing at 100%? Mm-hmm. Because really felt like against Chelsea, the bare minimum he should have taken for that game was a point. But mm-hmm. even then, after 90 minutes, you could see that Chelsea in the last 10 minutes showed a lot of character. Mm-hmm. For me, the mentality after going a goal down and coming back and winning that game showed that they are a team that knew precisely what was at stake. So for the Arsenal fans, I think you might have to buckle up a little bit because things are going to get worse before they get better by the look of things now.
You talk about getting worse, and as of now, 6 points behind the relegation zone. But that being said, Liverpool, at this point in time, you could probably say champions in waiting. They've had a very remarkable 2019, and a 1-0 victory yesterday against Wolverhampton Wanderers kind of summed it up. But in a way, we've got to credit Nuno Espirito and his men, because the way they troubled Liverpool yesterday, they are coming to their rescue.
Yeah, the VAR again, I think it was the center of attention over the course of the entire weekend, mm-hmm. because Norwich City as well are quite undone over the weekend. Timo Pukki there, who pretty much felt like he had scored a goal for his team to put them ahead, somehow mm-hmm. had a goal cancelled out. And in that Liverpool game, certainly for Sadio Mane, he'll be quite excited that, you know, the VAR came out and it pretty much ruled that there was no handball from Adam Lallana in the build-up to his goal. And then a couple of moments later as well, he played into their favour. So I think, just like you mentioned, for Liverpool, it looks like it's a matter of when, not mm-hmm. if, they mm-hmm. are going to be crowned champions. 13 points clear at the top. They've got a game in hand as it is right now. Of late, the chasing pack in Liverpool, in Leicester City and Man City look like they are slowing down. Mm-hmm. And Klopp knows that even when his team has bottled in the past, this time round it's everything for them. And clearly, I'd be more surprised if they failed to win this Premier League title, because everything is playing into their hands and the pieces are coming together quite well.
Brian, before we get into the stories themselves, last Friday, you and I, along with Lorien, did have a look at 2019. I know we had so much we couldn't cover up. So many sporting standout stories for 2018. But one of them, of course, was Cheptegei and the fact that he has had the consistency from 2018, the Commonwealth Games, right into the World Cross Country Championship, and then until, of course, the recent one, the IAAF. When you break it down from the locker scene, obviously international scene will come in later, but from the locker scene, you could probably say Joshua Cheptegei, the under-17 girls team, the Ugandan Cranes maybe, and then in there, you probably want to bring KCFC for their 13th league title. Then you have JKL. In your pecking order, who would you put first and who would come in last?
In terms of the outstanding moments from 2019, I think for me, top of the list would have to be Joshua Cheptegei. Mm-hmm. In every single international event that he took part in, he was heads and shoulders above all the opponents. You could speak of from the World Cross Country Championships in Aarhus mm-hmm. in Denmark. I could speak of him at the World Athletic Championships in Doha in mm-hmm. Qatar. You could speak of him at the 10-kilometer Valencia Marathon. I think for me, he was absolutely number one. In number two, I would have the netball Shikrains the Netball World Cup. And as much as they came home in eighth place, but mm-hmm. I really felt like they put in quite the shift for themselves. I would think in number three, I would have the Uganda Cranes. It was quite an interesting year for them. Mm-hmm. Going to the AFCON and qualifying out of the group stages. On top of that, they qualified for the CHAN tournament as well. We got to see them playing a couple of friendlies here, and they were absolutely brilliant. Though there was a change of guard in terms of management from Sebastian Di Sabri mm-hmm. and having Johnny McKinstry coming through. So I would have the Cranes in there. Mm-hmm. I would speak of the City Oilers. For me, they had an interesting year. They took part in the BAL qualifiers, even when they didn't qualify for the Continental Tournament, but I think they had quite the interesting outing. I would speak of them winning the CECAFA title as well. Mm-hmm. The JKL Lady Dolphins had an interesting 2019, so I would put them in the same bracket with the City Oilers for the year 2019. And on top of that, I would think of the athletes that represented at the All-Africa Games. Mm-hmm. You know, Isaac Masembe, David Semuju, Helen Baleke, each of them that went out there and came back with medals. For rugby, it's not been that big a year because you could tell the Rugby Cranes lost the Elgon Cup. Mm-hmm. They weren't that impressive at the Africa Rugby Cup as well, which they've won back-to-back at some point. And I think for me, they've got a couple of more years to go. But speaking of individuals that were outstanding, mm-hmm. Certainly Chirabo Namutebi, she had mm-hmm. quite an interesting year. Could speak of Halima Nakai, she deserves a mention as well. So there were kids that really came out and stood out when it came to sports altogether. Even Shafiq, that is Chiwanuka as well.
Oh, well, you brought him last. And, well, I guess between now and then, when he wasn't a known figure, I think you and I know the story began. But quickly, let's get right into the stories for the day. We do start with a giving hat. It's been all about giving in this festive season. And for former Cranes player in Karunji, that is, of course, Kalonji and his wife, Jacqueline Kalonji, came out to give back to society, and one school in Chibuti SS got some beneficiaries from Kalonji and Jacqueline's giving heart, and that was, of course, the volleyball court down here in Chibuti SS. Kalonji has been one of the few Uganda Cranes players who have actually come out time and again to give back to football, to give back to sport, and unlike Ibrahim Sekaja, unlike Masser, again, players have actually stood out and gained so much from football in terms of finances and what football has given back to them. But if you look at what football has given back to them and what they've given back to football, it's a whole different, you know, scenario. But the lady right there, Jacqueline, and the husband in Karunji are coming out to renovate the volleyball and the basketball courts in Chibuti SS. It should be quite the story. That is how it should be.
I think that's how it should be, because at the end of the day, truth be told, people like Henry Kalunji have gone out there and they've been quite fortunate or privileged enough to get all these opportunities in life. And his wife, that is Jacqueline Kalunji, came out and said, listen, I'm quite shocked and stunned by the quality of life I see back here, because she says back home in the States, she really struggled to find someone that doesn't have clothes on their back or probably who doesn't have shoes, you know, in their feet. Mm-hmm. But she came out and said that, you know, coming out in Kampala and having all these different experiences has taught her so many different things. But I think for me, for Henry Kalunji, he's always remembered where he's come from, because he left the country about 14 or 15 years ago. Mm-hmm. You know, he moved to playing at Winthrop University in the States. You know, he was one of the better players at the university. Mm-hmm. He got drafted by a couple of teams, including Charlotte Independence. You know, including a couple of other sides that he got to play for. And he made a couple of bucks, it's safe to say. And this time around, when he came back home, this was the fourth edition of them giving back to communities and the less privileged. So one of the things they did was that they decided to renovate the volleyball court at Chibuti SS. And then on top of that, he decided that he was going to have a lunch. He was going to share a moment with some of the kids that are come through the slums. Mm-hmm. And he also watched some of the feed, by the way, because he says this is one of the things that he takes away from the Bible. Mm-hmm. So it's quite interesting. But at the end of the day, girls go to play sports as well. There was a bit of netball. There was football as well. You know, he gave sports gear, including jerseys, including boots, including socks, including balls. Mm-hmm. And I think for me, that is what sport needs, because you can't give enough. So as many hands as possible, mm-hmm. I think for me, if we have all these guys coming back and giving back, then we can get Ghanaian sports to where we want it to go.
I guess in a way, when you look at, you know, things done by people like Kalunji, you've got to somehow, you know, appreciate them on so many levels. And for sport as a whole, it is important. That is why you have, say, charity matches, held for, you know, prolific players in their prolific clubs. That is why you have, say, charity, you know, games. And that money goes out to charity. But for Africans, I've seen Sadio Mane do this time and time and again, where he comes from in Senegal. Recently, there was a picture of his cell phone. He had a crack. A man who earns millions of money or millions of pounds could actually afford literally anything. But if you have humbleness and humility, and obviously, you know, to spend as much as you can to give back to society, to community, I think in a way it's got to be an example to the rest. But in Uganda here in particular, we haven't seen that much. And even when there is that much, you want to have or attract the media, maybe the public to come and see. But that being said, I think it's a massive, massive outing from Kalunji and the wife. And for sport as a whole, they've got to encourage these so-called stars or former stars who have enjoyed and, you know, benefited from sport to come back and give back to society, especially in this festive season.
True. I think there's players like Brian Omoni through the Brian Omoni Foundation.
As well.
He's done a decent job of giving back. Denis Onyango as well has tried to pull a couple of strings here and there. I think he's done so well. You know, you could speak of, names like David Oboa. You know, he's also tried to give back to the sport, probably through coaching and all these things. Mm-hmm. So clearly, as many hands as possible, as many of these former players who can come together and give back to football. For me, I think that is the way we need to go. Because truth be told, at the end of the day, you've got all these kids coming through the slum. You've got all these kids coming through from very humble backgrounds. Mm-hmm. And probably they have the talent, they have the dreams, but they do not know if they can actually achieve these dreams. And all they need is someone to come back out there and tell them, listen, I might have come from a place where you've come from, but you can come out of here and get to make something out of yourself. You can go and achieve everything you want to achieve. So if we have more of the so-called big names coming back and giving back to sport, then for me, it should be something quite good. But then also, on the flip side, you know, we've got all these guys coming from the youth and whatnot coming back to give back. How about the players that play right here? You know, the guys that have been playing in our league for quite a while. I think they made a few bucks that they can also give back. So we should not just look at the so-called professionals, but even the guys that are based here, they should be able to come back and give back to football as well.
Well, the least they can do is do community service, and that's, of course, as far as they're concerned, because they don't really earn much. But away from that, this morning, FUFA president in Moses Magogo did address the footballing fraternity in regards to 2009. 2019. As always, around this time, he usually talks the things he's supposed to be speaking about, scripted as well. And interestingly, he never mentioned the banning that he managed to get after something illegal happened. Listening to Moses' speech today was very much scripted, flipping pages, just going on about the points we've been given. But as a leader, I would think, you know, look back on how football has grown for the last 3 or 4 years in office and then try to tell us what could become of this football in this country going into next year. But interestingly, he talks about licensing of players. He talks about improving of judicial process. We know what that became this very year, just 2 months of being out on holiday. He also spoke about maintaining and building FUFO brand. That for me is a whole different avenue because as far as we're concerned, the FUFO brand has been rotting year after year. Interesting, he also talks about financing football activities with a $36 billion given to FUFA from all the private sponsorship fraternities, and also thank them for continuing to give for their their giving hand, if I should say. You spoke about starting 2020, all UPL players, 400 to be precise, will be getting health insurance, and furthermore, the sporting facilities will be a primary interest. Now, we've been having these things over and over again. It feels like the same speech from last year, just a few edits, and then going into next year, 2020. But your thoughts? I'm not being offensive. I'm simply saying what the guy said.
He did hint, though, on the two-month ban that he went on to serve. What he talked about was the criteria under which the tickets are given out. And he talked about the fact that they are sold over the internet, but Uganda had the opportunity to receive them in a different order. And he also talked about the process through which he went on to sell them to the third party that pretty much caused all the problems, including that petition from the FIFA, from the shadow sports minister, and that is Mr. Alan Sewanyana. But that being said, he hinted on the achievements this year. He spoke about how, you know, the Uganda Cranes went on to play at the AFCON, how they went on to qualify for CHAN 2020. He also spoke about the fact that the under-17 girls were quite phenomenal, winning the COSAFA, winning the SECAFA. He spoke about the under-15 boys winning the SECAFA as well. The under-17 team playing at their first AFCON ever. And he spoke about issues to do with the funding. Obviously, he went on to thank the different partners, including the sponsors, including FIFA, CAF, and government, who have pretty much injected money into football and made sure that football continues to grow in Uganda. But on the flip side, he also talked about the challenges. And one of the things he mentioned was that the quality of facilities is still a big challenge to football in Uganda, because he talks about how we've got only one national stadium, which happens to be the Mandela National Stadium. So he said going into 2020, that is going to be a primary focus. And I think for me, it's extremely important, because if we are going to get sports where I want it to go, then we need the facilities. Kids need to be able to understand that this is the facility where I can play the game of football and get to bring out my talent at the end of the day.
In a way, Brian, we were here last year and the same things were addressed to the footballing fraternity. And believe you me, from what we've seen in terms of growth, it's actually 0%, because as far as infrastructure development has been an issue. Nachivubo is still under, you know, construction, under a private owner, not FUFA owned. We still have Njeru Technical Center, the one stand. Nothing has been put across in terms of having more stands set up. This very season, this very year, we've seen clubs being reallocated in terms of hosting games, going from one place to another. That, for me, is just not fixing a problem, but rather just going on and talking about it.
One of the things that FUFA are doing is that they're trying to extend their headquarters. They're moving towards the east. They're also working on the Lugazi Stadium. I do understand that construction is currently underway, and they're trying to put up a couple of facilities, including the stands, including the dressing rooms, including the washrooms as well. So the hope is that these projects can continue to grow and get better. Obviously, the question of Nachivubo, when it will be completed, remains, because if you look at the time frame that had been initially given for its completion, that has not gotten to come through as well. So going forward, there is need for accountability. There is need for better resource allocation as well. The primary target should be improving facilities, improving sports, stadia as well, and also identifying talents from the grassroots. And one of the things he talked about was that I think starting next year, they will have the girls tournament, the Odilo version, for the primary schools to identify new talents coming through. So 2020 promises to be a big year for sports altogether, and it's good to see that AAR have come on board to offer insurance for players, which means that all the players in the top tier of Ugandan football, in the event that you pick up an injury, in the event that you pick up a permanent disability, everything is going to be catered for. And again, for sports players, the big challenge has always been what happens in the situation where I get that injury and the club can't finance it.
Definitely. And that drives us back to that scenario when the Nigerian born of Express succumbed to a very nasty injury. His leg went from bad to worse, started rotting. He was left in Kosa to work unattended. We had, of course, Natural Achiyinji make, well, countless visits until he was shipped back to Nigeria. Talk about the club can't have enough or doesn't have enough money to actually feed his bill. And in a way, you want to feel sorry for the foreign players. And in a way, if you are a foreign player, say, from the outside, if you got an offer from a club, you'd want to make sure that insurance for my injuries has got to be covered.
Yeah, it's got to, because health comes first. For me, priority should be how are you going to take care of yourself if you pick up any injury. And unfortunately, most of our clubs do not have the money. They do not have the resources to be able to take care of some of their key players. And probably they've also not taken care of the insurance as well. And you're thinking probably it's going to be KCCA. It's going to be, Vipers who can take care of the bills when some of their key players pick up some of those injuries. So I think for me, Fufa coming in and offering, a helping hand is going to be very important, because that is precisely what football needs. Mm-hmm. That is going to give more players confidence to get to play the game of football at the top level. That is going to give parents as well the confidence to be able to enroll their players, their kids into the league. And then also for most of their players, they'll come out there and give 100%, because they'll know in the event that I pick up any injury, that is going to be catered for. So for me, kudos to them. And hopefully they understand that with more funding comes more responsibility. That is as FUFA. With more funding also comes more opportunities to grow the game of football. Mm-hmm. And for Engineer Moses Magogo, the spotlight is now on him. How does he bounce back after the two-month ban that he went on to serve? So he knows that he'll need to go bigger going into 2020, and hopefully football can continue to go places, because next year there's a lot of initiatives. We've got AFCON qualifiers, we've got the Chan tournament, and the road to Qatar 2022 does continue in terms of the World Cup qualifiers. So there's a lot of football, both at the top levels, both for the men and the women, but then also at the grassroots as well. And it's upon FUFA, who have the mandate to grow football, to be able to get it to the place it needs to be.
Well, he also congratulated himself upon becoming the first Ugandan to have been elected to join the CAF Executive Membership Board. That and much more to follow right after the break, where the Sun Cranes returned home safe and sound with a silver medal, having finished second in the concluded Copa Beach Soccer Tournament down in Tanzania. And for former goalkeeper in, Nicolas Sewato, formerly at Ndou Baraka and AC Villa, has made a move to Kenya. That and much more to follow after this break.
Game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Game On is brought to you by...
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.